Hello dear students, I hope you all are safe and healthy. My name is Ankita and I am teaching as an assistant professor in Department of Computer Science and Engineering at St. Andrew's Institute of Technology and Management, Gurugram. I welcome all of you to the lecture 14th of my online lecture series of computer networks. And in this video, we will study various channel access methods. And these methods are also known as media access control protocols. So in previous video we studied Windows NT and 2000. We studied various features of these operating systems and what are the various components of these operating systems. In this video we will start with media access control techniques. So media access control techniques defines a method through which every computer on the network get to know when the channel will be free or when the channel will be busy. Okay, consider an example where we have six computers connected with each other, and they are named as 1 2 3 4 5 6. So computer 1 has data to send. Computer 1 sends the data onto the channel. Meanwhile, imagine computer 3 also have some data to send, and if it also starts sending the data on the channel, but the channel was already busy with the previous data. So in that case channel was busy, and in that case collision will occur when the channel is free for their transmission and when the channel is busy. MAC protocols or MAC techniques are introduced to solve such problems. Which defines that which computer is going to get access of the medium next. Okay, so these are the protocols for this purpose, known as medium access control. So it deals with two main questions, like where and how. Where refers the situation whether the control is exercised in centralized manner or distributed manner. Where means from where the signal will be originated. And in a centralized system, a master node is there who grants access to the medium to the other nodes. Okay, consider the client server architecture, wherein whenever a client requests for the channel that it wants to send the data, then server allows that client to have the access of that channel. So such scenario is known as the centralized scenario or systems. In this scheme, greater control will be provided, like priority will be decided by one system, overridden and guaranteed bandwidth will be there, and simpler logic at each node will be there. Easy coordination is there because only one node is responsible for handling all the allocation and deallocation. So it will be easy in terms of coordination. Although this approach is easier to implement, it is vulnerable to the failure of the master node and reduces the efficiency. So because all the functionality is based upon the centralized node, then there is more vulnerability of the failures. So distributed manner is the another feature, which says in this approach all the nodes collectively perform a medium access control function and they dynamically decide which node to be granted access next. And this approach is more reliable than the centralized approach. So OSI reference model data link layer contains two sublayers, LLC and MAC. LLC is logical link control and MAC is the media access control sublayer. So this sublayer provides certain protocols, or you can say MAC techniques, to solve such problems like where the signal or where the channel should send the signal, or which computer should get the access of the channel at what point of time. So it is also besides this, it is also responsible for the flow control and multiplexing of the transmission medium, and it also controls the transmission of data packets via remote shared channels. It sends the data over the network interface card. So DLL deals with the MAC addresses, Ethernet addresses, or NIC card address, you can say. So this diagram defines where the MAC layer sublayer works. So MAC address, or the media access control address, is a unique address which it deals with, which is allocated to the NIC card of the device or the computer. And it is used as a network address for the data transmission within a network segment like Ethernet, Wi-Fi, or Bluetooth. MAC address is assigned to a network adapter at the time of manufacturing only, and it is the hardwired or the code hard coded in the network interface card. So it comes with the computer only. It is not designed by the normal user. It is decided at the time of manufacturing. So a MAC address, we all know that it is of 48 bits. It contains the hexadecimal digits, which very much looks like this format. So functions of MAC layers are, it provides an abstraction of the physical layer to the LLC and the upper layers of OSI reference model. It is also responsible for encapsulating frames so that they are suitable for transmission via the physical medium. Network layer deals with the data unit known as packets, whereas data link layer deals with the data units known as frames. And it also resolves the addressing of the source station as well as destination address or the groups of destination stations. It performs multiple access resolutions when more than one data frame is to be transmitted. It determines the channel access method for the transmission. So these channel access methods we will be doing next. It also performs collision resolution and initiating the transmission in case of collisions. And it generates the frame check sequences, and it also contributes to protection against the transmission errors. So one part was aware of the two key issues of the MAC techniques, and the second one is how. How refers in what manner the control will be exercised. So it is constrained by the topology and trade-off between the cost, performance and complexity. The MAC techniques are divided in these groups, as you can see in this diagram: random access, round robin reservation and channelized. Random access techniques are also known as contention based techniques, and these four layers of random access methods we have to study. Okay, so before this we will see the round robin techniques. There are two round robin techniques. We have seen the centralized and the distributed manner. Okay, so these are the channelization method: frequency division multiplexing, time division multiplexing and code division multiplexing. So next is, okay, before the round robin techniques we will see the goals to design the medium access control technique. So first one is initialization. The technique enables network stations when they are power up to enter the state required for the operation. So initialization state or the initialization of the network defines that whenever we power up the network, then how it should be entered into the operation mode. Fairness says the technique should treat each station fairly in terms of the time, and if one station is waiting for 15 minutes, so all stations should wait for 15 minutes, not more than that or not less than that. So all stations or all computers should be treated fairly. And priority in managing access and communication times, that the technique should be able to give priority to some stations over the other stations to facilitate different types of service needed. Limitation to one station: this technique should allow transmission by one station at a time. And receipt means the technique should ensure that messages or the packets are actually received and delivered only once and are received in a proper order as well. So all these goals must be kept in mind while designing the MAC techniques. Error limitation says the method should be capable of encompassing an appropriate error detection scheme. Recovery says if two packets they collide with each other or if notice of a collision occurs, the method should be able to recover and be able to halt all the transmissions at once and select one station to retransmit the data again. Reconfigurability says that technique should be enable a network to accommodate the addition or deletion of the station with no more than a noise transient from which the network station can recover. So reconfigurability should be one aspect when we are designing the MAC techniques. Addition of nodes and deletion of nodes must be smooth in that MAC technique. Round robin technique says wherein all the nodes are getting equal chance to send the data. Each and every node is given a chance to send or the transmit by the rotation. When a node gets its turn to send, it may either decline to send, if it has no data, or it may send the data if it has the data. And after getting the opportunity to send, it must relinquish its turn after some period, maximum period of time. So means it will wait for its turn, next turn to come. So once it has sent the data, next turn, this computer will wait for its turn. The right to send then passes to the next node based on the predetermined logical sequence. So usually the sequence in round robin manner is clockwise manner. Right to send may be controlled by a centralized or a distributed manner. So there can be a one centralized computer, or there can be the distributed scenario as well. So polling is the example which is based upon the centralized control, and token passing is the example which is based upon the distributed technique or distributed manner. Polling says that it is equal to the procedure when a teacher calls the roll numbers of each student in the classroom, and whosoever student have that roll number, only that student says yes ma'am, present ma'am. So the message contains the address of the node being selected for granting access. Although all the nodes receive the message, but only the addressed node responds, and then it sends the data back. Or if there is no data, then it usually a poll reject. Suppose that computer doesn't have data to send at that particular time, then a poll reject will be issued. A poll reject message will be sent back. So in this way, each node is interrogated in a round robin fashion, one after the other, for granting access to the medium. The first node is again polled when the control finishes with the remaining nodes, and the polling scheme is very flexible of giving equal access to all the nodes, or some nodes may be given higher priority than others, or you can say the polling technique can be easily implemented. This is the diagram which depicts the working of or the working environment of polling. There is a central controller, these are the computers, it will initiate the message. Okay, this is the centralized computer which is managing all the resources, and which computer is issuing the broadcast messages to all other computer. And these broadcast messages will be regarding issuing the control of the signal or the channel to send the data. So if suppose this computer wants to send some data, then this computer will broadcast a message that this computer has its turn to send the data. So if when this centralized computer will broadcast the message, only this will respond. If it has data at that point of time, it will send the data immediately. But if it doesn't have data to send at that particular amount of time, it will send a poll reject message in that case. So polling can be done using a central controller as shown in this diagram. One station share a different frequency to send inbound messages, other stations share different frequency to send inbound messages, and this technique is also called frequency division duplex approach. And the main drawback of this technique is the overhead of polling messages and high dependency on the centralized controller. Polling can also be accomplished without a central controller. So in such scenario, all the station will receive signals from other stations as shown in this figure. So if we do not have any central controller, then it will work in this manner. In that case, stations have to itself develop a polling order list by using some protocols. So second one is token passing method in round robin techniques. In token passing, all the stations are logically connected in the form of a ring, and the control of the access to the medium is performed using a token. So we will understand this with the help of this example. Here we have four computers, and they are connected with a logical ring with each other. So whenever a computer wants to send some data, it will acquire this token. This token is a pattern or a packet, you can say, which revolves in this ring, and whosoever client is ready to send the data, it will acquire this token first, and then it will attach the data with it, this token, and it will circulate this token again on the ring. In that token, destination address will be there. So it will revolve in this ring. Whatsoever computer is having that destination address, it will, when it gets matched with the destination address, it will acquire the token, detach the data, and circulate the token again with the acknowledgement. So when again this token will go to the resource computer which sent the data actually, it will see the acknowledgement that the data was delivered. Okay, so this is the token passing method. It can be implemented with the token ring as well as the token bus. Okay, so in case of token ring, a token is passed from a node to the physically adjacent node, and on the other hand, in the token bus, a token is passed with the help of the address of the nodes which form a logical ring. So in token ring there is a physical ring, but in token bus there is a logical ring. So we all know that bus topology is a channel basically through which all the computers are connected, and to make work that topology in the case of token passing, it will form a logical ring. So all the channels will be connected to the ring logically. So these were the token B, bus token ring and token passing. So these were the token passing and polling approaches for the round robin manner, and this scheme is efficient compared to the polling scheme, but it relies on the correct and the reliable operation of all the nodes, and it again have some problems associated with it, like lost tokens, duplicate token, insertion of a node, removal of a node. So all these are the issues of concern here in this token passing. Second one is contention based approaches or random access method, you can say. So in round robin techniques they work efficiently, but with the majority of stations they have data to send most of the time, but in situations where only few nodes have data to send for brief periods of time, then round robin techniques are not suitable. So contention techniques are suitable for bursty nature of the traffic where you have lots of data to send. In these techniques there is no centralized control, and when a node has the data to send, it contends for the gaining control of the medium. And the principal advantage of contention based technique is their simplicity. So Aloha is one first protocol which was introduced in 1970 by Abramson, and it was first used for the packet radio networks, which was connecting remote station to the central computers and various data terminals at the campus of the University of Hawaii. So this is the scenario of the packet radio networks, where in different frequencies were used. Stations were using frequency F1 for sending the data, and central computer was using frequency F2 to send or broadcast the message towards the clients or the computers. So it was divided into two types. Pure Aloha and Slotted Aloha. In Pure Aloha, users are allowed to send the data randomly, and they allowed random access of the central computer through the common radio frequency F1, and the computer center broadcast all the received signals on a different frequency band 2 as shown in this figure. So this enables the users to monitor packet collisions, if any, and the protocol followed by the users was simple. Whenever a node has a packet to send, it simply does so. This is known as Pure Aloha because it is truly free for all scheme. And frames will suffer collision, no doubt, that no other station is knowing that that second station also has sent the data. So collision will be there, and colliding frames will be destroyed in this scheme. So there is no provision to recover from the collision. And stations, on the other hand, will not get to know that their packet was collided. So they have to wait for a random amount of time, and they will retransmit the data again, but they will not know after what amount of time they should resend the packets or frames. Okay, so this is the diagram to define the scenario in a Pure Aloha. So these are these three stations. This is the broadcast channel. So station 1 sends the data, 1, 2 and 3 frames were sent, and station 2 sent 1 and 2. So these stations are not knowing that station 1 or 3 has already been sent the data. Station 2 will not know about them, and station 3 will not know about these two. So this is a channel C. This was the station 1 packet frame, and this was the station 2 frame, and this was the station 3. So there is complete collision because two frames collided with each other, so there will be complete collision, And as it is shown that station 2 sends the data here and station 1 already sent the data, so there will be partial collision. So you can understand this with the help of this diagram, which is showing the vulnerable time associated with each packet. This frame collides with the beginning of the red frame from here, and this frame collides with the end of the red frame. So this was the complete collision, and this packet also got affected with this collided frame. So it may be noted that if all the packets have a fixed duration of tau as shown in this figure, then a given packet A will suffer collision if another user starts to transmit at any time from tau before to until tau after the start of the packet A. So as you can see, when it was at its beginning, it collided with the another packet, and when it was ending, it collided with the another packet. So it got affected with these two frames or packets. So this particular amount of time when it started its collision and its ending point where it ended with the collision, so this period is known as the vulnerable period, which is denoted with the help of this tau. Okay, so this gives vulnerable time to 2 tau. Based on this assumption, the channel utilization can be computed. So the channel utilization in this case is computed with the S throughput. So this is the formula to calculate the throughput in the pure Aloha, and based on this, the best channel utilization we can achieve is 18%, which can be obtained at 50% of the dead offered load as shown in this figure 14.8. Okay, so to improve this channel utilization on the offered load, the second type was introduced, which is named as the slotted Aloha. So this is the chart through which the throughput of pure Aloha and slotted Aloha was compared. In pure Aloha, the vulnerable period was double, but in slotted Aloha it reduced by a single value. So here it is minus G and here it is minus 2G. We will see how in slotted Aloha every computer got a slot to send its data. So this is the, these are the frames, and this is the time slot wherein every station got time to send the data. So in this case, the channel is divided into slots equal to the tau, and the packet transmission can start only at the beginning of the slot as shown in this figure, and this reduces the vulnerable time from double tau to single tau, and it improved efficiency also by reducing the probability of collision as shown here in this diagram. So station 1 send the data, broadcast channel, this is the broadcast channel, station 1, station 2. So here again station 1 and station 2. So in this case the collision was removed to some extent. So this is the complete collision. There will be no partial, or you can say incomplete collision in these cases. This gives the maximum throughput of 37% at 100% of offered load. So it was far better than the pure Aloha. The second protocol or second technique was CSMA, carrier sense multiple access. So in Aloha, what was the scenario? The channels were not able to detect whether other channel is sending the data or not. So they were sending the data at once as and when they have data to send. So they were not sensing the channel whether it is busy or free. They were just sending the data whenever they had data to send. So in CSMA, carrier sensing was introduced. Okay, so due to this, that Aloha was not having carrier sensing, so it encountered poor efficiency. So in situations where propagation delay of the signal between two nodes is small compared to the transmission time of a packet, all other nodes will know very quickly when the node starts transmission. So here propagation delay between two nodes was very low. So all the channels were get to know that there is collision and we should not send the data. And in this scheme, the node having data to transmit first, they listen the medium or the channel to check whether the another transmission is in progress or not. Carrier sensing was there. The node starts sending only when the channel is free, that is, there is no carrier, and that's why this scheme is also known as listen before talk. And this is further of three types: one persistent, non-persistent, and p-persistent. One persistent says if the channel is sensed free, so when a computer have data to send, it will first sense the medium or the channel. If the channel is free, the medium if the channel is free, it will send the data. But if the channel is busy, the node continues to monitor until the channel is idle. So it will continuously sense the medium, and when it finds the channel free, it will send the data. In the case of non-persistent, if the channel is sensed free, the node starts sending the packet. Otherwise, the node wait for a random amount of time and then monitors the channel. In one persistent, what was happening? The node or the computer was continuously monitoring the channel until it gets free. But in non-persistent, it will sense the channel once. If the channel is busy, it will wait for random amount of time. That time is decided by the administrator only, that how long, for 10 minutes or 15 minutes it should wait. It will be decided by the administrator only. So it will wait for that particular amount of time, and then it will again sense the channel. If it is free, only then it will send the data. In case of p-persistent, if the channel was free, the node or the computer starts sending the packet. Otherwise, the node continues to monitor until the channel is free, and then it sends the data with the probability p. So the node in this p persistent case, it will continuously monitor the data, and if the channel was free, it will send the data but with the probability p. So this probability will be 0.1 probability can be there. So that is, again, probability will be decided by the administrator only. So the efficiency of CSMA scheme, that depends on the propagation delay, and which is represented by the parameter a, propagation delay divided by packet transmission time. So it can be noted here that smaller the value of the propagation delay, lower is the vulnerable period, and higher will be the efficiency. So propagation delay says the time up to which the computer gets to know that where that there is collision on the transmission. So if this will be low, efficiency will be high and vulnerable period will be less. Okay, so next protocol was CSMA series. In CSMA, only carrier sensing was there, but collision was still there in CSMA case also. So collision detection protocol was introduced. CSMA CD protocol was introduced, and it can be considered as a refinement over the CSMA scheme. In CSMA, what was happening when two packets collided, the channel remains unutilized for the entire duration of the transmission time of both the packets. And if the propagation time is small, which is usually the case compared to the packet transmission time, so wasted channel capacity can be considerable. So the wastage of channel capacity can be reduced if the node continuously monitor the channel while transmitting a packet and immediately cease the transmission when the collision is detected. Okay, in CSMA, the channel were continuously sensing the medium or the channel for the time when it gets free. So this continuous monitoring of the channel while transmitting the packet also. So in CSMA, the channel were continuously monitoring the data, and they were, as and when they detect the collision, they were stopping the transmission when the collision was detected. And so this wastage of channel capacity can be reduced if the nodes continue to monitor the channel while transmitting a packet and immediately cease or stops the transmission when the collision was detected. So this is the refined scheme of MAC techniques over the CSMA, which is also known as listen while talk. So whenever you are sending the data, you will still sense the channel besides. So on the top of CSMA, the following rules were added to make it CSMA CD. So if the collision was detected, the first rule says that if the collision is detected during transmission of the packet, the node immediately ceased the transmission when the node started transmission, but it detected the collision after the transmission began. So it will cease the transmission or it will stop the transmission, and it will send a jamming signal for a brief duration of the time to ensure the or to inform the all other stations that there is collision or collision has occurred on the channel. Second case was added that after transmitting the jamming signal, the node waits for a random amount of time and the transmission is resumed after that time. So these two rules were added in the CSMA to make it CSMA CD. So as and when we have started the transmission or the computer has started the transmission of the packet, and after that it detects that there is collision on the channel, it will initiate a jamming signal which will inform all the other nodes that there is collision onto the channel. And after the jamming signal will be issued, the node will wait for a random amount of time, then it will start the transmission again. So the random delay ensures that the nodes which were involved in the collisions are not likely to have a collision at that time of retransmission. And to achieve the stability in the back-off scheme, a technique known as binary exponential back-off was used. So this back-off time was that random delay for which the node has to wait until it starts the retransmission. So the node will attempt to transmit the packet repeatedly in the face of repeated collisions, but after each collision the mean value of the random delay is the doubled. So random delay value gets doubled after each retransmission. So in this back-off exponential back-off algorithm, what was happening? It is actually defining the way CSMA CD worked. So when a packet is ready, it will wait for some time. So deferring on says that it will, whether it is waiting for some time, if it is waiting, then it will again go to the ready state, and if it is not waiting, it will start the transmission. So when the transmission started, whether the collision detected, if no, then the transmission will be completed. But if the collision detected during the transmission, then it will go to this phase where it will initiate a jamming signal, and in this jamming signal it will inform all the other nodes that there is collision on the channel, and no other node will send the data during that particular amount of time. After sending the jamming signal, it will increment the attempts. Attempt says that the number of attempts it has transmit the packet. Okay, so if the attempt is greater than 15, then that packet will be discarded forever. So it will not be retransmitted again. So if the attempts are less than 15, then back-off time will be computed. Back-off time says that the duration for which you have to wait until you send the packet again for the retransmission. So back-off time will be calculated. When it is complete, it will again go into the ready state, and again it will wait. If it is waiting, then it will go to ready state. If it is not waiting, it will start the transmission. Then again, collision detected, then it will again increment the attempts. If attempt is still less than 15, it will compute back-off and wait for the back-off time, then again go to the ready. So this is showing the retransmission. This portion is showing the retransmission after every failure. And if the attempts are greater than 15, it will discard that packet forever. It will not send it again for the retransmission. Okay. So if collision was not detected, it will transmission will be done, and it will show the transmission was successful. So this is the binary exponential back-off algorithm on which the CSMA CD worked, and this is the table which is showing the throughput formulas for all the protocols like Aloha, Slotted Aloha, non-persistent CSMA and non-persistent CSMA CD. Okay, so this was all about your medium access control protocols. though these are of four types as we saw in this diagram here. These were of four types, but the random access methods or contention based random techniques, they are of more concern here, and MAC sublayer used these four protocols. Basically, we have also seen the round robin techniques, polling and token passing, reservation we have seen, and the channelization. So this was all about the MAC techniques. Enough content is there in this video so that you can attempt your final examination also. We will see next topic in the next videos. Thank you so much. Take care.